The Unprofessional Boxing Podcast. If you wanted professional, you came to the wrong f***ing place.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of the Unprofessional Boxing Podcast. We have stayed the course. We continue to record consistently. I do not know how long this will last, but you have joined us on this very bizarre boxing journey. My name, of course, is Boxrec Gray. You can follow me on Twitter, BOXRECGREY, and continue to consume, share, like, subscribe, tell all your friends about this podcast, where you can find podcasts everywhere: SoundCloud, Stitcher, Google Play, iTunes. iPods don't exist anymore. They're gone. So I don't know how you listen to iTunes. I guess on a laptop. Tim Boxeo's got the YouTube account finally going after I never did it myself. So yeah, speaking of Tim Boxeo, he's here too. Tim, how you doing, man?
I'm doing great. I'm like a school kid 10 days out from summer vacation. There was so much boxing last weekend and so much coming up that, my blood pressure started to rise here as we were preparing for the episode. I'm super jacked.
This is a jam-packed episode, Tim. There's a lot going on in the world of boxing, and there's no way we're going to be able to talk about it. If we wanted to talk about the whole thing, Tim, like everything we want to talk about, this could be like a four-hour podcast, but we don't have time for a four-hour podcast, man. So we're gonna hit the high notes, and as always, don't forget to follow all of the Tim Boxeo universe, right? And a big part of that is, of course, the newsletter that Tim's putting out, which is really, I think you could say, a supplement to this podcast. What we don't cover, You're going to find it in the newsletter, Tim. And I would say the Discord as well, where you can find like-minded individuals who enjoy boxing. You've created quite a community there, Tim.
Thank you, brother. Yeah, we're just getting started though. So, like Gray said, just come on in and jump in, and it gets especially active on club nights. So it's a lot of fun.
Join the fucking movement. That's all I'm gonna say. All right, let's talk about last week. Let's recap the big winners and the losers, Tim. And I don't think there's a single winner bigger on this weekend than Jamal Woods Thursday night. The man with that record of, I think it's something like 25-59 and 9 draws, a heavyweight barometer. But Tim, you caught his that card on Thursday night in Texas, and we saw Jamal Woods put together quite a performance.
Yeah, it was a really good show. I enjoyed it. They kept the pace moving really well, even before the main event when it was time to get to Terrell Woods and Rolando Soto. They just brought the guys in the ring and we got after it. So yeah, it was overall a really good event. I think that was on Fight TV.
Yes,
on Thursday night.
It was part of the Fight Plus package, I believe.
That's right. The Fight Plus, $4.99 a month. And we already got this. We already got this one under our belts, you know. I don't know how you can do better than that. You watched this fight too, right? Did you watch it live as well?
I did not watch it live. I saw the highlights.
Okay.
I saw Woods stop his opponent impressively in two rounds. I mean, this was not just a points win, Tim. This was a demolition of an 8-0 prospect. I have to say, he looked like he was very motivated in there.
And let's not forget, not only an 8-0 prospect, but Rolando Soto being the reigning, as they announced him, WBC Fekerbox Bridgerweight Champion.
That'll get you a top 40 ranking in the WBC at the Bridgerweight division right there. But yeah, we saw Jamal Woods use that size. He used his hand speed, his veteran prowess. I was very impressed with him. And Tim, like a true warrior that Jamal Woods is, he has a fight lined up in 11 days from now.
Well, he does, and you know, the two things that Woods did really, really well in this fight are, number one, he just I mean, he got in there, and I think he knew that this is a fight he could win. So he just started letting his hands go, yes. And he doesn't have a lot of power, but you can tell, you know, when a 250-pound dude hits you, that's 6'4" or whatever he is, it's gonna move you back. And then number two, he knows all the tricks. So even in this 2-round fight, the movement he was doing inside the ring and making Soto miss him. And so I saw the fight coming up in New York here in 2 weeks, just like a week after his suspension from Texas ends, just from, you know, the fight itself. And it's against a Polish heavyweight that I've seen a few times. Damian, I don't know how to say Damian's name. It's Knaiba, Knaiba.
Perhaps.
Big guy, 6'7". A little... He moves in the ring almost what not almost he moves in the ring exactly what you would expect a 6'7", 250-pound Polish heavyweight moves in the ring.
Not fast.
No. So he has been the lead push on this Polish promoter's card. So I don't know, like, if they don't know what they've bit off here, but. Once again, if Jamal shows up and decides he wants to fight, we could have some interesting action that night, too.
He is 6'7 with a 86-inch reach, apparently. That's insane. 86-inch reach. Yeah, I think that New York, a typically very strict commission, they don't like fighters with losing records. But I think in this case, they rightfully looked at the numbers. They crunched the data. They took their time. And they approved this fight because... they know it's likely going to be very competitive. An unproven prospect, albeit a giant man, taking on Terrell Woods, who has fought and even defeated, it seems like, a who's who in the heavyweight and bridgerweight division. Let's not forget about the bridgerweight division here. So that was Thursday, Tim. Did you do anything on Friday? Well, how was your Friday? I was in a car accident, so my Friday was shitty.
I know, I saw you tweet that out, but everything's fine. You're okay. Let's put everyone at ease.
Let's talk about it real quick, because you know, it's not boxing related, so let's plow through this. My wife was just trying to cross to a left-hand turn, trying to cross a bunch of lanes. Car runs a red, going straight, and then hits us. She didn't see it coming, so unfortunate. You know, getting T-boned. I took all the impact on the passenger side, but I was fine. Shout out to airbags, by the way. Airbags are cool because they definitely were the reason I didn't go to the hospital with, like, a broken arm or something. So, yeah, we were kind of shook up. But at the end of the day, like, car's going to get fixed. It's repairable. We're fine. And we have another car anyway where, you know, each of us has a car. So, granted, the other car is a Subaru pushing, like, 125,000 miles. But I would say I had my very controversial spotted at Creed 3 moment because very quickly, I'd say an hour after the accident, after I walked home, I felt bad. My wife was really shook up, so I ended up driving to buy us sandwiches. I was still kind of limping around. So if you saw me buying sandwiches on Friday night in this random town in New Jersey, you know, buying cheesesteaks, I just want to let you know I was injured, no joke. Injuries are, you know, I'm fine now, but I know it might cast suspicion, so I'm good, but... Yeah, yeah. Life goes on, man. That's how it is. But I just wanted
Thankfully, life goes on. We're happy you're doing all right.
Yo, thanks to everybody who sent me really nice messages. By the way, I'm like, you know what? Like, it sucks getting in a car accident, but it could have been so much worse. Like, this was, you know, I'll take being like sore and thinking I have like a fractured arm for a minute over like, you know, a hospital visit. So I wasn't concussed or anything. I mostly just felt like I got punched very, very hard on the right side of my body. That makes sense.
Jesus.
But Tim, did you do any boxing relating things on Friday? I ended up watching BKFC after on delay. I didn't watch it live, but that was the only thing I did.
I was going to ask you if you watched BKFC. Yeah, I did watch some boxing related stuff. Nothing I'll spend a ton of time on. Just one I did want to mention because it was kind of funny is Fight Zone UK in the afternoon in Scotland, Glasgow, had a main event between King Gardner and Marios Matamba. Two light welterweights. Gardner ends up getting a razor thin referee decision of 96-94. which probably should have been like 97-93 the other way.
Wow.
And shout out to my guy, King Dinesh on Twitter, who has basically taught me everything I know about how to find streams online over the last 5 years, because they held up a belt that this fight was being contested for before the fight. And I got to have a screenshot of it on my Twitter. And it's just a big R with diamonds on it. Okay. It was the Ringside Promotions championship belt. And then King Dinesh replied and said, I think that should stand for robbery after that fight. So I thought that was a pretty good quip. Was the only boxing related thing I watched Friday.
No bearing on the Fight Zone service itself, though. I'm a big fan of Fight Zone. I think it's a good amount of money a month for the amount of content you get. I think it's like €5 a month, I want to say.
Dude, it used to be they cracked it down to $2.
$2? That's
crazy. It's $2 now. Yeah.
That's a good deal. If you're not subscribed to that, give them, for love of God, give them some money. Because those shows, they put on a lot of content, man. Like, I feel like every weekend they have a show.
We'll be talking about one in our previews here a little bit later. But hey, the other thing I wanted to tell you, I watched. I'll make this really quick because it's not boxing related, but I watched the Slap Fight Championship. Shout out to Fight TV again.
How was that?
Oh my God!
First time.
I've seen slap fights before, you know, not only on the Jake Paul content, but I've seen Russian slap fights.
Okay.
On Fight as well. This is my first time seeing the actual Slap Fight Championship brand.
Worth it.
And. It was more entertaining. It was very entertaining. I almost wonder if the packaging could improve from... I don't think they need to do it live. Like, I don't think it really matters, right? It's not like there's a crowd.
I was going to say, does it matter that it's live? Also, does it get boring after a while? Or, like, do you think it actually has a little longevity?
Well, see, that's the thing is, I think if they packaged it different without it being live... They could keep it moving at a quicker pace, but they had a few hiccups. One of the fighters did all the promos and everything and then didn't show up when they like literally called his name to walk out. So then they had like 15 minutes to fill, and they kept going back and forth between what was apparently live to package stuff. And it was just, the production was hard to follow. So I think if they tightened it all up,
it
was only a 90-minute broadcast, do it in like 60 minutes. It was pretty damn entertaining. I mean,
interesting.
I enjoyed it. Yeah. Anyway, that's that. Friday was pretty a low point.
So Friday's a low point. Saturday comes up. I'm one day rested. It's still a little sore. I didn't get to go out and do much, unfortunately. Did get to catch plenty of boxing that day. Tim, the first thing that pops up on BoxRec for Saturday that I want to talk about is something I saw on your feed as well. I didn't see this fight, you did, but there's an interesting BoxRec note on this fight already, and there's a lot of controversy attached to it. It took place in Nova Scotia, and I want you to tell us a little bit about Ryan Rosicky fighting Yamil Peralta from Argentina.
Oh, I you know what? I didn't see the BoxRec note, but I think I know what it's going to say.
Yeah.
It was a fantastic fight. It was on both Tech Sports in Argentina, and then I paid for the Canadian pay-per-view to support my Canadian boxing promotion friends. And Ryan Rosicky, no doubt about how tough that guy is after we saw in his Bridgeweight World title fight.
Sure.
Went 10 rounds with Argentine Yamil Alberto Peralta, who was 12-1, I think.
13-0, apparently.
Oh, 13-0. Yeah, sorry. He falls to 13-1. So Rosicky takes the win. It's a split decision. Basically, the story of the fight from round one all the way through round 10, without just breaking it down as we go, is pretty simple and straightforward. You just have the two very different contrasts and styles that you see so often in boxing. Rosicky's kind of lumbering forward and just trying to throw, you know, haymakers. And knock Peralta out, trying to throw big, heavy shots to the head and body. And Peralta is just boxing his ears off by moving, sticking and moving. He didn't stay in the pocket very often. I never felt like he was running, but he was moving a lot. And Rosicky just could not cut off the ring. Rosicky takes a split decision, 97, 93, 95, 94, and then the one card for Peralta, 94, 95. Peralta even lost a point in the 10th round for holding. Now, I tweeted this out after the fight. Credit to Rizicki. Rizicki has been a guy, if you're not familiar, got into a bunch of domestic, not a bunch, but got into domestic trouble. Potentially not, you know, but had, how should I say this? Had some problems outside the ring, right?
Sure.
So some people have been not so happy with him. Within the ring, though, the guy is a badass. I love watching him fight. And then after the fight, and I quoted this on my Twitter, he said, hey, I may have been the aggressor, but Peralta outboxed me tonight. He taught me some lessons. I need to do better with my defense and use my head for more than just taking punches. So very gracious in the ring. He had a couple of black eyes, exhausted. You know, he could have easily won off, and he handled it with class. And then, Gray, what? I think I know what you're going to say, but what's the box rec note? What happened after the fight?
I've never seen this before. It just says, although the result stands, after talking to the supervisor from the WBC title fight, because this was, again, an international cruiserweight title fight, basically just means the winner would have gotten like a top 5, top 10 ranking. Talking to the supervisor of the fight as well as the promoter of the event, as all the officials were from Canada, the WBC decided the title stays vacant. So I believe that means that neither fighter would ranking on their WBC is probably going to be affected by this, and Ryan Rizicki is not the new champion either. So, I mean, obviously you can't really overturn you just can't overturn decisions. It just doesn't really happen in boxing unless you can prove, you know, obviously corruption, but I was surprised to see all three officials were from Canada. They usually try not to do that. So I guess they probably recognized him that they got, you know, the decision wasn't fair. Somebody got screwed here. And they're using the all the officials were from Canada as kind of the excuse to not give Rizicki the title. Is that what I'm getting? I think that's what I'm getting.
Yeah, I think you nailed it. I watched this fight round by round. There was no way Rizicki won more than two rounds.
Jeez.
And that was being generous. And one of the scores was 97-93 for him.
Horrendous.
That was pretty wild.
Part of it is inexperienced officials. I'm clicking on these guys' contract pages, and they haven't judged that many fights. So.
Yeah, and especially in the hometown, and Rizicki was coming forward most of the night. You know, I could see how that could trip him up. So I think, let's see, I tweeted something out. I don't have it in front of me. But I don't know if they've nailed down the exact date, but I'm pretty sure they already announced this fight's going to rematch in October is the month.
All right. Good. I'm glad they're going to do the rematch. Peralta deserves it. But yeah, I wasn't surprised, man. He seemed on paper like a better, you know, better than a lot of these guys that come from Argentina. Like he had a lot of amateur experience. So no surprise to hear him, you know, using his legs and preventing him from cutting off the ring. Tim, I'm going to talk about a lot of things before I get to Canelo. I'm just saying here. If you're a listener to the show, you know this is the deal. I want to talk about a fight that took place in Germany between two women that blew my mind when you sent me this clip. You just said, Gray, take time out of your day to watch this. It's 2 minutes, not an investment. And you sent me a four-round fight. I don't even know what the name of this town is. It looked like it was in a club somewhere. I have no idea. But it was between the pro debuting Madeline Morhart, I guess, and her opponent from Danka Matijasevic. I don't even know how you say it, but can you just describe this fight that you sent me that took place on Saturday? Because it was, I could not believe what I was seeing.
Well, I was hoping you were going to describe it for me. Take me off the hook here. Okay, so
an Instagram model.
Let me add some
fighting. I would say Morhart is like an Instagram model, very attractive woman, fighting somebody who looked like they had just borrowed a pair of shorts and outfit in like stretch pants were, like, it was just, the whole outfit was very strange. We've watched a lot of women's boxing in the U.S., and I'm like, there are a lot of rules they're not following for this fight. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't see, like, any chest protectors or anything like that. Just, they kind of just, they looked like they were fighting in gym shorts, you know, gym clothing. Does that make sense?
Yep, you perfectly described that. So this was actually paid for this pay-per-view in Landau, Germany on Fight 24, which is a platform out of Germany, because someone who I've developed an internet friendship with named Fatih Altınkaya Karakurt was the main chief supporting bout, and he moved to 27-0 with 25 knockouts and took a WBC cruiserweight continental title.
Hell yeah.
And yeah, one of the ladies he's training is the one, the fight you're describing, Madeline Morehart. And I think Instagram model is a good way. Madeline also has some other features in her link tree. If you wanted to click on those and subscribe for $7 or $8 a month.
Oh boy. Okay. We get your drift.
Yeah. So there's that. And, you know, she's working in the gym, trying to be a professional boxer. She's obviously in very good shape, so she got that going for her. But shout out to the Sunday Puncher Boxing podcast. I forget who it was, but someone within their Discord sent me her opponent, Danka Matijasevich, also a German gal, who was 0-3, knocked out three times. Her previous fight, they sent it to me, and... it looks exactly like the one you just described, or the one we watched from Saturday.
I think the best way to describe it is she looked like she was forced to fight at gunpoint. Looked terrified. And basically exactly how an average person off the street, if they were forced to fight in a boxing match, would perform. She got knocked down once very quickly, turned to the referee and said, "Fuck this.
Yeah.
I'm good.
I'm out.
Fuck it."
Hey, there's growth there. There's growth there, Gray, because this her previous fight that was sent to me, it lasted about 90 seconds. Okay. And she was warned about three times for kicking. So I think we're...
She figured out what sport she was in. That's good.
Uh-huh.
Yep. That's awesome. Yeah, she looked terrified. But I mean, let's keep in mind, this is like the 13th fight on a 14th fight. You know, deep undercard. Like, you know, it's not like this was the main event or anything, but just, you know, sometimes these fights happen, man. That's all I'm going to say. You just, you know, deep on the undercard. That's why we watch these shows, Tim. You find the jokes.
Gray, that show went on for like 7 hours, and I was DMing with my boy, King Dinesh, and he was asking me, you know, questions about it. And I just told him flat out, I'm like, I just wanted to see if I could do it. You know, it was like, I had my, you know, my fluids lined up. I had chips ready. I just wanted to see if I could get from the start to finish without tapping out. And I made it.
Sorry. Give me 1 second.
Nah, no problem.
Sorry about that. Am I sounding okay again? Sorry.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you sound good.
Okay, thanks. No, yeah. I mean, listen, man, that's what I love about these European cards is that, you know, especially with, like, Russia, these countries, you're going to get just an absolute afternoon's worth of entertainment. It's just all day long. They just piling in WBC regional title fights. It's quite a sight to behold. Tim, I want to mention, I'm going to give a shout out to the American Boxing Federation, because I am technically their ratings chairman. So,
oh, yeah. Look at you.
I know.
Yeah.
It's very strange. But I do help them out. And I saw that in San Luis, Rio, Colorado, in Sonora, our champion at 122 pounds, Donna Bolanos, retained her championship. I saw some footage of it on Facebook. It was on a grainy cell phone. It's exactly how I want to watch a Donna Bolanos fight. She's only 18 years old, but she's good for 18. Like, I think she's somebody that, if, like, she stuck to boxing, I bet she doesn't train all the time. You know, like, it's sort of like a, you know, when she
She probably got other stuff going on in her life, but she's still a good enough boxer to beat some of these locals. So I don't know if she'll ever really go above the scene in Mexico unless she really commits. But yeah, for 18, I thought she was pretty ta you know, she's pretty talented. I mean, I don't know. Have you seen her fight, Tim? I don't even know.
Yeah. I've seen her fight a bunch of times, and she's exciting. I mean, she comes forward and just lets her hands go. Tuzita Bolanos.
She's a
There
character on
was,
Facebook. That's all I'm gonna say. She's a
that's
character.
one way to say it. Yep, that's definitely one way to say it. Don't dig too deep on
No, don't.
her other accounts, especially not at work. So, the crowd was not happy. I think I didn't put this in my tweet when I tweeted out the result, but the scores were 60-54 and then 58-56 times two, and she beat a gal who was 2-2-1, Miss Contreras Ibarra, and it looked like it could have went either
I
way
agree.
based on the crowd and based on what I watched.
It's hard to tell
So
with the
yeah.
grainy cell phone footage, but it looked close for sure.
Yeah.
So, you know, that happened. yeah, don't look at her social media. That's all I'm gonna say. Anyway, Bare Knuckle in Thailand, Tim. Did you watch the show at all? Did you get to watch the man who we pretty much devoted last week's episode to, Saramon Cole Singwancha's fight at 183 pounds, 85 pounds, against Mikal Vitrilla. Did you get to watch that at all?
I did. I'll tell you. I woke up at 3 a.m. Saturday because there was back to back, or there were two Australia shows, and then I just kept running all day
Love it.
until the end of the Canelo fight, and so I saved the BKFC Thailand because I figured it was pretty easy to stay away from spoilers. I turned
Sure.
it on Sunday morning and I watched it. It was really enjoyable.
It was a
I really
fun card.
liked
Yeah. I'm
the
gonna throw it
card.
out there that the level of fighting on the on these Thailand shows are actually better than the level of fighting in the US.
Yeah. I mean, I think they mix in some. How do I pronounce it, Gray? What's the bare knuckle
Oh,
in
Lethwei?
Thailand where you can?
Lethwei or whatever you're talking about?
Yeah, I
Yeah.
think those guys do that too. So,
Oh no, these dudes are
you know.
fighting all the time. Like some of these guys in the
Yeah.
undercard look like they probably had like hundreds of fucking full contact kickboxing shit under their belts. Like these were hardened kids, even for like 20 years, you know, some of them were like 20, 25 years old. No, you could tell they've been through a lot of fights. And they knew what they were doing in there, and they could hurt you. But I don't know. But for me, I guess the highlights was watching Steve Banks and his very dirtbag haircut come back from nearly being knocked out to defeat Akbar Karimi in the only heavyweight fight on the card. And TJ Chang and Fabiano Hawthorne throwing down for 5 rounds and then wanting to beat the shit out of each other after the bell and not yet giving each other any respect during the scorecard announcement. So, and keep in mind, like these were, I think this show was done on like in either closed doors or very small crowd because you know they take COVID seriously in that country. They you know there's actually face masks still over there. So, very interesting to see the presentation of the card itself. I don't know if you noticed that, Tim.
Yeah, I did. The TJ Chang fight was one of the highlights, other than our guy that we'll talk about here in a second. The TJ Chang rematch was one of the real highlights. These guys hated each other. At one point, what was his opponent's name again, Gray?
Fabiano Hawthorne.
Yeah, Hawthorne, right? Yeah, sorry. So Hawthorne at one point just literally winds up and knees TJ right in the balls after clinch. I mean, just clear shot to the gonads. And I love TJ Chang for all kinds of different reasons. One being that he's from the UK and his name is Thomas Newton. And two, that his name, he changed his name to TJ Chang and lives in Thailand,
Hell
goes by
yeah.
the Hellboy. I watched back in like 2018, 2019, he showed up on these Bone nightclub shows in Pattaya,
Yes.
promoted by Evolution Fight Series. So as a boxer,
Shout out
he
to
was
John.
really,
Shout out to
really.
John Nutt.
Yeah, John. John, shout out to John Nutt, who is a character. Excuse me, who's a
Absolute
character.
fucking character. The best.
So T TJ was super chinny in boxing. He's record 3-4. All four bouts he was knocked out in boxing. And then makes the jump, of course, to bare knuckle fighting, which makes complete sense.
Yeah.
And actually does really well in bare knuckle for the fights I've seen him in.
Yeah, he so the first fight between these two took place outdoors. It was extremely hot, and TJ Chang had to quit in between rounds due to heat exhaustion. Because it was that, I mean, it probably was over 100 degrees out. So I don't blame him for being like, fuck this. But
yeah. He was winning every round.
He was, yeah, he was. And, you know, just ran into, unfortunately, some bad luck. All right. I want to also go on and talk about, Tim, if you didn't notice, was the card in Florida. With all the Cubans on it. This was a card. Once again, our friends at the old Fight TV put this one together for us. So we appreciate, you know, I always say go on their website. They have streams every weekend. And, you know, you'll find something up your alley for a pretty fair price. Like, at least in my opinion. And I have to say I was very pleased with the amount of fights on the show. I think it was like $13. And... yeah, it had a couple of regional title fights. Again, most of the Cubans obviously kind of won, so it shouldn't surprise you. But one thing I did notice, Tim, was a cruiserweight title fight, which was very interesting, between David Light and Anthony Martinez.
Well, okay.
Did you end up...
Tell me about it.
Yeah, did you end up watching this card at all? I wasn't sure if you caught it. I apologize.
No, I didn't. What did I have on? So I had to make a game time decision because I had the Canelo. Because sure. Gosh damn, man, the Canelo card started at like 3:30 Central Time.
Yep.
And so I had that on, and then my other screen was dedicated to what, Gray? What was I watching on Saturday after? Oh, of course, we just talked about it—the Rosicky fight. So I had Landau Germany going all afternoon, and then I plunked on the money for Nova Scotia. So my screens were all tied up and I left. I saw our guy Deuce tweeting out results on Twitter for this as well. And it sounds like you watched it. So no, I missed the card in total. So tell me about it.
Yeah. I mean, so basically keep in mind, you're watching this card and it's like a bunch of Cubans that are older, but they're making, you know, a lot of them are making their pro debuts early in their careers, and they're all taking on guys they flew in from Argentina who are very mediocre. So it's pretty much knockout, knockout, knockout. And then you get to Anthony Martinez, who is 12-1 with 11 knockouts. Anthony White Chocolate Martinez. Let's keep that in mind. And the opponent they flew in was not a guy from Argentina. In fact, it was an Australian cruiserweight named David Light, who was 17-0. And I was actually – so when I saw this, I was like, man, this is actually a really tough fight for Martinez, and he could probably lose this. That was my first thought seeing it on paper. Fight occurs, and we get – not only does Martinez lose, Tim, he gets knocked out in the first round, and I'm going to say it, a donkey punch KO. Like, I think Light kind of caught him on the back of the head. Like, I wouldn't say it was like a blatant rabbit punch, but it definitely did not catch him, like, in the front. And I think the referee kind of missed it, and Martinez was dazed, looked frankly out of it, and the referee did the right thing, waved it off. But I was like, man, it kind of looked like a foul almost. But anyway, you know, for the short period of time, Light looked pretty dominant, and he rightfully made the right investment coming over on a long flight and picking up a regional title for the WBO on a card that was otherwise, like I said, dominated by Cubans. In the main event, Lenier Pero, who I really like. I think he's going to be a guy that you're going to hear about it more of. He had a really exciting fight on a PBC undercard in January against a fellow Cuban named Giovanni Bruzon. Took on Hector Perez, who was 7-4, and 7-4 now, but he was a veteran of a couple top rank bubble shows, and Pero got him out of there pretty quickly. And I think it was more because Perez came in fresh off I think he was probably on the couch for a bit before he took this fight because he was not in top shape, and he got blown out pretty fast in three rounds. But I was a little disappointed with that. And also, Orestes Velasquez, who's 3-0, Again, one of these Cubans with a ton of amateur experience. He's already 28 years old. They're moving him quick. Second round stoppage blowout over two-time world champion Juan Salgado, which I thought was interesting. That's the same Juan Salgado that knocked out Jorge Linares. So, granted, he's on the back nine now, but I had to mention that. And also, Tim, I don't know if you noticed this or saw this in the BoxRec schedule, but do you remember Jermaine Franklin at all?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Comes in and fights in Gary, Indiana over the weekend. Rolls in at 277 pounds.
Holy shit.
Not in shape. But he's back, and he knocks out a 2022 Rockin' Rodney Moore. So in case you were wondering, Jermaine Franklin, who if you've watched Showtime, you're like, whatever happened to him, he's back after a very long layoff. All right. I feel like we're obligated to talk about the Canelo undercard. So, Tim, I've been rambling a little bit for the last few minutes, so I'll give you the floor here. You know, we're selling out a little bit, so we don't have to talk about it too long, but what did you like? What were your thoughts about Canelo?
Well, I was going to say,
Canelo card. You don't have to talk about Canelo if you don't want to.
Okay. I was going to, well, I do want to. So you said,
all right.
You handed it over to me and said, you know, the Canelo undercard. And I was actually kind of looking forward to the Canelo undercard when we were talking about it with Corey Erdman on our last show, because there was a few nuggets in there that I was like, okay, well, this is something I want to keep an eye on. And I just could not stay engaged with it, man. Like, other than the Zhang KO1, it was just white noise. I couldn't get anything out of it. Did you like anything on the undercard itself?
No, not really.
Okay. Yeah. Me neither, man.
I was physically there, and I don't feel like I processed anything. Does that make sense? Like, I saw it
in my eyes,
but it just didn't really hit my brain. Yeah, Zhang getting a KO and a giant chain from the Barstool guys after ruled, whatever. That was really funny. I mean, I don't really care about the Barstool brand, but just the fact they were just trying to get cred by hanging out with a 39-year-old Chinese heavyweight is just very funny to me. But Zhang did exactly what you're supposed to do with the late replacement, and you get him the hell out of there really fast. And if anything, he boosts his you know, credentials for that fight with Hrgović. I mean, I thought Hrgović was going to destroy him, and now I just simply think Hrgović will beat him instead of just destroy him. Zhang can punch, man. And we saw it there. But yeah, I thought Gyasov looked pretty disappointing. I thought Montana Love was disappointing. I thought Mark Castro was disappointing. And really, I mean, if you were a Canelo fan, Tim, the greatest disappointment of them all was Canelo just not being able to figure out Bivol and keep up with his pace, man. It was something else to watch.
Yeah, I had my Canelo t-shirt on. My wife had her Canelo headband on. We were shocked. You didn't come to this podcast to hear our breakdown on the result of it.
Yeah, you don't give a
what
shit.
I will tell you is what I do like doing on big fights like this, just to see how much traction I get, is I tweeted out that I had scored at 120-108 for Alvarez, and I did get some people that took the hook on that one, which is fun. That's fun. And then I tweeted out the truth, which was, like I told you, I woke up at 3 a.m. to watch two Australian shows, and I just kept rolling on boxing all day and tweeting out results and watching boxing. So by midnight Central Time, when the scores were read, I tweeted out what the truth was, which was I scored at 117-111 for Bivol, although I did sleep through around 6, 7, 8, 9, and part of 11. So take that for what it's worth.
I think Canelo was sleeping during those rounds too. So I mean, I knew that he was – my only comment on this is I knew Bivol had won the fight basically after – in round 10, because Canelo worked so hard to win round 9. Like, he put everything into winning round 9, and he knew he had to. And those last three rounds, he just had very little to offer Bivol at that point. Because a true champion, he didn't have the tank for those last three rounds. Like, I'm sure he knew he needed to grab them to win the fight, but he just simply didn't. Like, he got outworked, and you got to win those last couple rounds, man. I mean, literally, if Canelo had swung, I think, one round on any of the judges' scorecards. Like, just one round at the end there. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. You know, he gets a draw. Two rounds if he swings on those cards. He wins. And he didn't. He didn't win, he didn't win any of them. So, that to me was the big key. Was just, it was 10, 11, 12. That told the story for me. Anyway, the fact that it was even that it was even that close, just goofy Vegas shit, and I don't want it. It just makes me depressed to think about like what would have happened if one round swung on a judge's card. The discourse on Twitter would be much different and really unbearable. So we were spared. But anyway, Tim, I want to talk about you know. Have you heard about Justin Mayweather Jones? Do you want to go into that? Let's talk about Justin Mayweather Jones. Are you familiar with Floyd's half-brother, Tim?
He actually looks a lot like Floyd. When he I does. Saw your tweet. So I was really I was busy with my son last night. So you're talking about the show that was on Fight last night from Mexico. And I was busy with my son, so I didn't get to watch it yet. But I am going to watch it here as the week goes on. I saw your tweet.
The Trillerverse bus, Tim, went down to Tijuana. God bless.
Oh, it sounds like I missed a great event.
It was, I mean, what made it great was they showed every part of that card. You know, I thought at first, was like, oh, we'll probably get the 10-rounders. No. You get the 4-rounders. You get everything. You get Floyd Mayweather's half-brother coming back off of a 2-year layoff, managed by a guy who is currently trying to sue BoxRec, which I'm also like, who also paid to have himself listed as Justin Mayweather's promoter. So we got your money, bitch. And he's 35 years old. He's fought, I think, 7 times in 9 years. And, when I put the tweet out, I was just laughing, not at him. I was laughing at just the fact that he popped up on a show in Mexico. That's all. And someone wrote, like, oh, why should you make fun of someone who's just trying to make a career out of it? First of all, he's fighting as a hobby. He's 35, and he's fought 7 times in 9 years. Calm the fuck down. Second of all, he's fighting a guy who's about 5'3" and is rolling in at, like, you know, fucking super middleweight. Yes, that's funny. Yes, I'm going to enjoy that. It's not making it's funny in the sense that it's like they just popped up on a show randomly. So I just want to make that clear. It was just like, why is Justin Mayweather fighting on Antonio Lozada's undercard? I don't know why. I just don't know why this is happening. That's all. That's what made it funny. Just did not expect this to happen.
So Gray, let me interrupt you for a second. So this plays right into a wheelhouse of mine that bothers the living shit out of me. So there's a certain YouTube team, so to speak, that covers all the mainstream stuff, right? Sure. Religiously, and they have for a number of years. And they took some gigs covering club shows.
Oh, like
Deep South and in southeastern United States,
Deep South, brother. Yes, I know what you're going at.
And not that you and I would be real good at this, so I hate criticizing someone's broadcasting skills because I'd probably suck at it. But one thing you have to recognize when you look at some of this deep undercard stuff is, I'm sorry, but it's funny. Like, if you don't think it's funny, then you just are missing the whole thing. Yeah. And it's not a disrespect thing. You know, we respect, you know, their courage to go in between the ropes. Yeah, don't give me some shit that they were training for 10 weeks leading up to this fight, right? Like, this guy is a whole different animal.
This guy was, his opponent was not on BoxRec when they were in the ring. I had to add it on BoxRec. So don't tell me that they had an eight week training camp and they were buckling down. Don't give me that shit.
No.
So just want to get that out there. But anyway, I'm really happy to see the Trillerverse bus rolling into TJ yesterday. The other thing, Tim, is that they're doing is I guess we can dovetail this into their show on Saturday. So they were doing a lot of promos for their card on Saturday, but interestingly enough, it really wasn't centered around Sergey Kovalev fighting Turvel Poulev, and it wasn't even really centered around Kubrat Poulev fighting Jerry Forrest, and it wasn't centered around young Evan Holyfield at all. It was actually all of it was centered around Fernando Vargas and his three large sons, who are all fighting on this card. And yeah, it was interesting because I think, here's my theory. Triller, what I love about Triller is they'll never leave money on the table in an opportunity. And I think they have a reality show with these three. These kids are they're kind of funny. They have they're characters. And Fernando Vargas is also a character. But yeah, it was just, you could kind of tell that they want to make a reality show out of these three. But have you actually seen any of Fernando Vargas's kids fight before? Yeah, obviously you have probably haven't seen Emiliano because it's going to be his pro debut. And apparently he's the best of the three. But I was going to ask you, have you actually seen Fernando Jr. or Amato fight?
I have, yeah. I've seen both of them fight all of their fights, if I'm not mistaken.
Wow, okay.
So I'm very familiar. And our guy, Beto Duran, pointed me towards the youngest one, saying that he's, you know, the most talented. Yeah. And I think
he is.
Me, you, and our friend Corey were trading messages. And Corey said that, you know, he's been fighting since he was little, unlike the other brothers. But, you know what? The old man's doing it right. I mean, this is they should get a reality show. They yes. should milk this shit because you're right. Those kids are really
put them on YouTube.
They're interesting.
Get them a show. Yeah, it's an interesting backstory. I think they can all fight at least a little bit, so that makes them interesting, and they all seem like they have characters. But I, you know, again, this is I like to see more of this. I like to see guys, you know, using that charisma. And doing more than just tweet out their next fights. So, but I just wanted to point that out, that Triller definitely, Ryan Kavanaugh had the light bulb went off in his mind when he saw these three. So I think that's what I'm looking forward to mostly on this card. Obviously, Cruiserweight Kovalev and Turvel Pulev just sounds bizarre that it's even happening. And Jerry Forrest, Tim, is a guy that can always pull off an upset or give a really good performance. And, you know, Kubrat hasn't been in a ring, in an actual boxing ring. We're not going to count Triad here, but in like 2 years. So at least you get a little bit of interesting stuff on the top. But I'm excited to see these Vargas kids. I want to see if they can actually fight.
Yeah, those two fights on the, you know, for weirdos like us, those two fights on the top of the card are really interesting.
Yeah.
To see what happens. And, you know, here's what. So I've seen Fernando's fights in Amato too, and you know what the thing is? It's the typical shit you get when they have a really famous dad. Like, everyone wants to jump in and say they're not shit, right?
Yeah,
oh, these
of
kids are terrible, whatever. You know, are they going to be future world champions?
Probably not.
I doubt it. But they're not nearly as bad as everyone says they are either. So
yeah.
It's just usually like anything in the world, it's a little bit in between.
Yeah, I saw Fernando Jr. fight Cody Kabosky, and I mean, honestly, Cody was fighting New Hampshire guys that I've actually called his fights. So he wasn't really in there with much in his career, and he went over there 2-0 and fought Fernando. And I think, like, you know, just getting the sparring out in California and Nevada, like, is going to make the Vargas brothers better. Like, they're just going to be in – they have superior resources than all the club-level guys they're going to be in the ring with. So, of course, they're going to win their early fights. It's just, you know, the question probably won't be answered until when they get to 8-10 round level. So, but I'll enjoy the journey to that, to the ride when they beat these guys they're supposed to beat in the interim. But, my God, we have I'm overwhelmed, Tim, because I'm looking at the schedule and there's so much to go, so much to talk about here for Saturday. It's just.
I know.
It's truly just what a ransom we have here. We have to go into. I think we got to go into this show in Florida first, Tim. The Creator Clash.
Okay.
The Creator Clash.
Oh.
Yes. This was when I heard about the Creator Clash. I immediately was like, "This is exactly up our alley. This is why we do the show, Tim." This is why we do it.
So what's okay, let me share like a 2 minute backstory here. So every week I put together a schedule and stanza, right, that for live streaming links, and Saturday was there's so much on the BoxRec schedule that like my wrists were hurting, you know, my fingers were killing me, and I only got up to like the UK point of the BoxRec schedule, so I hadn't even touched the US yet as we're getting ready to start recording tonight. And you sent me this link to thecreatorclash.com. And I mean, I just thought, how did I miss this up to this point? Like, where have I been the past 3 weeks? This looks like the greatest event since YouTube versus TikTokers from like 18 months ago.
So appropriately, it's in the only state it should, an event like this should be in, which is Florida. It's in Tampa at the USF Sun Dome. So shout out to friend of the show, Marquise is going down there. So he'll give me a live
read. Oh, awesome.
It's probably do a little bonus podcast next week and do like a little interview with him at some point. But what makes this show so fantastic is we're going to go into all the YouTuber bouts in a minute. But the lead-in to the exhibition YouTube fights are going to be actual pro boxing matches. They're giving away the pro boxing matches for free. Like, that to me is just so funny. So you're gonna, so if you go on to, like, I forget, you know, I think it's one of the main YouTube guys' accounts. I think it's this guy iDubbbz. We'll talk about him in a second. I believe they're gonna stream Hot Rod, if you remember him. Kalajic, the light heavyweight who fought Artur Beterbiev, will be in action against Ernest Amuzu. And 5-0 Fabian Andre Lopez Nieves from Puerto Rico will be taking on 1-1 Rufino Lewis. So you get those fights for free. That's the lead-in. Now, Tim, what I'm going to do in this next segment here is I'm going to just read you off. You're a little older than me, so, you know, I'm sure YouTube is not your demographic at all. And I'm in my mid-30s, so I it's a little bit more of my demographic, but trust me, I think it's fair to say I'm also a little too old for this. So I'm going to just read you the names of the first, the commentary people, and I'm going to ask you if you've heard of any of them. And I'm going to then tell you if I've heard of them before the show, and then we'll go on to the fighters. We'll just see how well we do here. Are you ready,
Tim? Okay. I am. I feel as an upstanding, honest man, I need to tell you one piece. I need to disclose something to you.
Okay.
You sent me the link. I'm sitting on the couch. You sent me the link like an hour ago.
Okay.
I was sitting on the couch with my laptop in my lap. My 16-year-old boy is next to me.
Oh.
And I said, son, let's take a look at this together. So I have that research with alongside of me.
Okay.
And now volley back to you. Let's go.
All right. So just tell me if you heard of any of these guys. Yeah, we'll maybe talk about a few of them. But if any of them, just say yes or no if you've heard of any of them before I sent you the link. Okay. Here are the presenters. Akinola Verissimo.
Never heard of him.
Wade Plemons.
No.
FaZe Sensei.
No. However.
Exactly. However.
I think from my experience with the YouTube versus TikTok and the whole FaZe clan, is he part of the FaZe clan?
He is part of the FaZe clan, and I believe he was supposed to be in a YouTuber boxing match. It might have been on one of those KSI Logan Paul cards. I forget he was supposed to fight, but he's the guy that got hurt playing touch football and he had to pull out.
Okay. So, okay.
Q-Cow? I don't know who the fuck this guy is. No, I assume.
Yes. Okay.
You know this guy.
So my son sees his picture and goes, "Holy shit!" And I said, "What?" And I can't remember how he said this person's name. So this dude live streams Overwatch on Twitch. Okay. He's got 10.7 million followers on Twitch, and the guy's worth over $10 million.
Oh my God.
Now, he nearly got canceled, or did get canceled, and now he bounced back for some less than savory comments. But
I'm just gonna say, I think all these guys have probably been canceled at some point.
Yeah.
All right. Moist Critical.
No.
I actually knew this guy. I've seen him before. He looks like Andrew WK. He literally ripped off Andrew WK's look. He has like 10 million followers, and he talks in it. He's kind of funny. Like, I don't watch his. A lot of his content, but I've seen a few of his videos, and he's like a very monotone comedian, comments on a lot of, you know, YouTuber drama. Most of it I do not know or care about, so it's no reason to watch his videos, but I am aware he has a large following. Okay, Estevan TV.
Never.
Looks like fucking bait, like a young Mario. Mario fucking Plumber. Just fantastic mustache. Chills. Are you aware of Chills?
We're laughing, right? But our guy Chills has almost 6 million subscribers on YouTube, so he's laughing at us.
I've actually seen Chills. I know of Chills' account. He does like 30 scary things, and it's like, they're really weird. They're actually really funny. Like, his voice is like, I don't know if he does it on purpose, but if you like listen to his videos, the cadence of his voice just doesn't sound human. So I think it is part. I do genuinely think this dude is performance art and not taking it very seriously. So, God bless him for grifting his way onto this fucking show as a commentator. All right, so let's now get to the fighters here, Tim. Again,
okay.
Main event here, iDubbbz. You ever heard of iDubbbz?
I have not.
I had never heard of this guy at all. He's taking on Dr. Mike.
The side-by-side of these two guys is so good. Couldn't be any opposite, any further from each other in terms of their looks.
Let's give them the breakdown here. Dr. Mike looks like a perfectly chiseled and fucking incredible shape. I watch videos of him. He absolutely goes to gyms, and like he spars with probably local amateurs, right? Like, this guy is in shape. iDubbbz is a mustache and a terrible chest tattoo, and he has, I think, 6 million followers, and is going to get fucking murdered. It's the best way I can describe it. This will be an execution. That's all I have to really say about that. All right. Harley from Epic Mealtime. Are you aware of him, Tim?
No.
Okay. I am, because that account's been around for like 10 years, and I watched it in my mid-20s, and it's basically an account where they make atrocious food items that are high in calories, and then they eat them. That's all Epic Mealtime really is. And the account has... They're definitely not as relevant in, you know, modern day, because that shit gets old. So he's definitely doing this to stay relevant. And he's taking on a guy named Ego Raptor from the Game Grumps channel.
Never.
Okay. Yeah, same here. Okay. Internet comment etiquette. I guess that's his name. Internet comment etiquette.
Oh.
Okay.
I'm going to save you the time to bouncing it over to me every time and just tell you my blanket answer for all the rest of them except one is no.
Okay. All right.
Never heard of any of these people.
Okay. Feel free to interrupt me when you do. Internet comment etiquette, I am aware of. This guy was on the internet way back in the day doing videos where he would smoke take salvia, I guess smoke it, and do funny things. And they were really funny videos. Like, I watched them in college, I think. And now he does, I guess, a shtick. I don't really know what a shtick is, but I was very happy to see that it's the same guy that I was watching content probably 15 years ago. He takes on DJ Welch. I have no idea who the fuck DJ Welch is. Then we go to Hundar versus AB from the H3 podcast. No idea who the fuck these guys are. Hundar is wearing a Bad Religion cutoff shirt and absolutely would murder me, like, in the back of a bar. Just fucking put me in a coma. Next fight, Yodeling Haley versus Justa Minx. Gotta have the women on the show. Equal rights, equal fights. Sure. Never heard of either. Can't wait to see it, though. Ryan McGee against Alex Ernst. Now we're just getting down to dudes that look very normal at this point. We're past, like, the muscle, scary muscle men, and we're just looking at average guys. Never heard of either of these guys. Matt Watson versus Dad.
I love this one. I love this one.
Dad mm-hmm. looks like a dad. He is just dressed as a dad. he is in a shirt, short-sleeved button-down with a tie on, and he looks like he's balding. So Matt Watson is going to fight Dad. Cruiserweights. I Did a Thing versus The Odd One Out. I have no fucking idea who these two are, but they look like young millennial YouTubers. This last fight. Oh, I forgot to look at this one before. Oh no. These two guys, lightweight division. Michael Reeves, who looks like, I'm not happy how much I look like Michael Reeves in this. He looks like maybe 15 years younger than me, but like, just imagine if you've seen a photo of me, just a very glasses clad, dorky looking kid, taking on a guy in a fucking suit named Graham Stephan, who also does not look. These dudes do not look like they have an ounce of athletic ability. I can't wait for this. Holy shit! Maybe they'll prove me wrong. But Tim, this one's the most insane of all.
And this is the one that my son couldn't believe that Michael Reeves was on this card. So you click on Michael Reeves' little link below his name, and it takes you to his YouTube channel. He's got 6.72 million subscribers, and he looks about 15.
Yeah.
And he's got like his 15-year-old friends reacting with him next to videos. And then you click on Graham's video or YouTube link. He's got 4 million subscribers almost. And there, you know, he's in a suit, and there's a Porsche there. And neither one of them look like they've ever touched any sort of spherical object that would require, athletic ability.
Graham Stephan, so it looks like he's an investor. So this is like two investor YouTubers.
What's up, you got?
At it. Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to. Sorry. I clicked on his account there. But yeah, literally all of his videos are about recession and profit. And this looks just awful. So yeah, we have two guys fighting who are investors, Tim. That should be great.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that one.
Fuck me.
So the pay-per-view is $25, and my son has already informed me that we're buying it just for that fight. So, okay, son, let's do it.
I think I could beat those two up. I don't know if I could beat anybody else up on this card, but I know very confidently I could beat Michael Reeves and Graham Stephan in a fucking fight. I'm very sure I could.
I would definitely shade you against both those guys.
Yeah, for sure. I don't think I could beat. I would take myself as an underdog against Yodeling Haley. I don't think I could beat Yodeling Haley. I know I can beat Michael Reeves. I'm just making that clear.
God.
Yeah. Fuck. All right. So we go from that, Tim, to what the other important event that's taking place on Saturday, and that's the return of Floyd Mayweather Jr., the greatest of all time, Tim. And the greatest of all time, sometimes that bank account needs to have a couple of million added to it. And that's when the feelers go out and the questions get asked, who's going to pay me an insane amount of money to fly me to some country to fight God knows who, God knows where? And we got our answer, Tim. The answer is this Saturday, our friends at Fight TV, shout out to them, are going to be hosting this one. Floyd Mayweather, Tim, Floyd Mayweather's coming to Dubai, baby.
So in my research for this, Floyd Mayweather is fighting a Midwest journeyman.
Yes.
Right? And
correct.
Who's 18-0? 18-0-2?
18-0-1. Yes.
18-0-1.
Dangerous Donnie Moore.
Dangerous Donnie Moore. Donnie has not fought since, I don't know if his box record up. Is it 2016?
Floyd's been more active than Don Moore. Yes.
Okay. All right. Perfect. And that is about all I knew of Don Moore until about 2 hours ago, when I realized that this is like Floyd's lifelong sparring partner that he's literally just beat up for like the last 15 years.
Phenomenal.
Oh.
He's getting paid millions of dollars to fight his longtime sparring partner on top of a giant building on the helipad. You think he's going to knock him out? Hell no. It's going to be 8 beautiful, beautiful rounds of light contact boxing, Tim. And I cannot wait for it.
Who's behind this? Who is Global Titans?
Who isn't Global Titans, Tim? Who isn't? Global Titans could be a lot of things. What I do think it is a very mysterious group of investors who have promised Floyd Mayweather somewhere in the range of $5 to $10 million to show up for this event. I don't think Floyd gets off the couch for under $5 million. I'd say five. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Because he was shopping around like an exhibition fight. I heard rumblings a few months ago, and he was shopping around options, and there were fighters that were, trust me, even worse than Don Moore. Well, worse than fighting his sparring partner. At least Don Moore. I mean, I will say this is going to be Floyd's first fight with a guy who's been boxing his whole life since like 2015, right? Because you got McGregor, you got the Japanese kickboxer, and you got Logan Paul. So those three, throw them away. This guy's actually had 19 pro fights. Granted, he knows the deal, and Floyd knows the deal, but it is kind of funny. Like, it just, I have to buy this, Tim. Like, it checks all the boxes.
Oh, I'm 100% in. And I think you were the one that told me. Oh, no, it was in, shout out to the Sunday Puncher guys again. So there's an interesting thing here, right? There's only so many tickets you can buy for this event. Like, it's a very limited crowd base. Like, I don't know the number. Let's say it's 100, but it's small.
It can't be that many. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's small. And the only way, and the tickets are like $100,000, right?
Holy shit.
And the only way you can buy them is by NFT.
Yes.
So we will know. And they've got it listed. God. They've got it like all posted. Holy and listed shit. The NFTs that you're buying as a ticket to get in. Oh, so this will be the first, I think, fight in the history of the world.
This is brilliant.
That we'll know exactly how many tickets were sold for this.
Oh my God. Dude, how many people do you think are selling their Bored Apes to get the money to buy these tickets? Actually, NFTs like took a big dive in the last 2 weeks. So I feel like maybe not, but that's wild. So I mean, is this the first time an NFT actually gets you something other than a shitty JPEG?
That you could just take a screenshot of.
You can actually get into an event with it. That's what a concept. What a grift. This is definitely some dubious activities going on, but we would be amiss to say, Tim, if we didn't talk about what also was on the show, because there's actually non-exhibition bouts on here. And Tim, I think you'd agree with me, it wouldn't be an exhibition fight card without Baudu Jack showing up for this one. Every fucking exhibition card this guy is on the undercard, getting paid handsomely.
Oh, I'm sure he's getting a lot of money.
He's getting six figgies, and he's getting paid to fight very mediocre opposition. God bless him.
God bless him. Seriously. Dude, this is what we all want in life. The most money for the least amount of work.
Oh, he gets fights on the Tyson Roy Jones undercard and beats up a white guy in Blake McKernan. Then he gets on the Floyd Mayweather Logan Paul undercard and defeats Dervin Kalina. Both those guys were unbeaten, to be fair, but again, nothing to close to what Badu's accomplished. Fights fucking dumbass Samuel Cross and knocks him out in Dubai. And now he's back at it again in Dubai, taking on Hani Atio from Egypt.
Jesus, of all the names that I've come across over the years, that's not one of them.
Yeah, I was gonna say. So, is this a guy that I was shocked. I thought you were gonna go, yeah. So, I've watched a lot of stuff from Cairo over the years. I'm very familiar.
Shout out to Cairo. We do have a Cairo card on Saturday. Deep, deep club show. Ooh. And I might remind people that the last two bouts ago, when we had a deep club show in Cairo, part of the ring started on fire due to pyrotechnics. So you never want to miss a live and free club show on YouTube on Saturday. But no, this dude, he is nicknamed the Egyptian Hurricane. So for that very reason, I am going to be rooting for him. Hey, he fought Pavel Sauer.
He did. He fought him. This is it. He fought him last month. Hold on. We need to run down his last month.
Oh, wait.
No, dude, yeah. This is good.
Hold on. Yeah. I see it too. Yeah. Okay, go.
Yeah, so he fought Pavel Sauer, who you might remember fighting on Showbox. I believe he fought Jermaine Franklin on Showbox. Anyway, he got stopped in three rounds last month in the Czech Republic. So again, not even a month ago, 3 weeks ago. 14 days later, he fights an 0-1 fighter named Georges Michel Baguiana from Cameroon. He fought him in a Radisson. Fought him in a Dubai Radisson. Shit. Picks up a 4-round win. So no suspensions apparently in Czech Republic. Just good to go 2 weeks later, pal. So now he's fighting again 14 days later after that against Badu Jack. Jesus. That's just
and
like
I guess,
insane to me.
I guess I don't remember this. How could I not remember this? So our friend, Russian citizen Roy Jones Jr. knocked him out in 1 round.
Yes, he did.
In 2014. I don't remember that fight for some reason.
Did the job for Floyd, or for Roy. I mean, that was like Roy's. Roy was doing a lot of, like, you know, foreign fights at that point, and I think, you know, just kind of got lost in the shuffle.
Mm. This is great. You know, the only thing I think that'll keep this show from very good to potentially the epic level is Floyd's involvement, because usually what happens when people that don't always throw boxing events throw a big boxing event, we get all kinds of crazy shit going on between the fights, right? And I just think maybe with TMT and Mayweather Promotions involved, Floyd's done this so many times that he's going to streamline that shit out of it. I'm hoping I'm wrong, but I just hope we see some crazy ring announcers and just weird entertainment between the fights. And
need a ton of weird interviews, weird dancers. I need lots of in-between shit for this to be successful. Yeah. Again, Fight TV's got the pay-per-view, our friends there. One more fight that I couldn't believe was on this card at one point. Delphine Persoon was going to fight Maya Bahamadoush, which I was like, what? That's one of like the best fights in women's boxing you could make right now. Like they're legitimately probably in the top, you know, 15 best in the world. I mean, Persoon's probably still in the pound-for-pound top 10. Hamadoush is probably in the top 15. Clearly, there's money being thrown around here. Pearson's still on the card, but she's now taking on a 15-0 opponent named Elhem Mekhaled from France. So still a pretty interesting fight, Tim. But it's just like it's a reminder of like when you just have tons of money to throw around, the fights you can just make at the last second that are actually pretty good.
I know that would have been a great fight to see. Everyone loves Delphine Persoon. She just brings all action all the time, but that Ryan Ford fight fell off, so that leaves us only two pro fights.
Yep.
Is that it as far as you know?
Buddy, there could be an undercard worth of shit by Thursday afternoon. I don't know. Dubai, yeah. It's Dubai. Like,
right.
I'm
fair.
Just amazed that those fights even popped up. all right. I'll let you have the floor and drive the car here because I feel like I've been doing a whole episode. I apologize. Tim, what do you got? What's on the docket for that you're excited about for like Friday, Saturday? I mean, again, we have a little bit of, we got some time left on the show. We're over an hour, but give me some stuff that you just got to mention before we wrap up here.
Oh my God. There's so much. It's caught. I don't smoke weed, but I feel like right now I need to. Like,
okay,
there's so much I can't. Okay, if you don't subscribe to my Substack, you're gonna have to, because I'll put the rest of what I have here that I wanted to talk about in my Substack as a supplement to our pod.
There's so much,
so we don't go for
so much going on. Like, I would go on for another 4 hours. It's crazy.
There's so much good club shit, like that Egypt show I just mentioned. So sub to that and get some of the extra nuggets. Let me just narrow it down to three. Okay, number one, and we're going to pray to whatever you want to pray to, whoever you are, that on Friday we get a live stream from Panama, because there is some club gold on that card. One, who is 42-year-old American heavyweight fighting out of Colombia named Carlos Welch, / Bridgerweight. Just kind of floats in between, is fighting former, and Carlos is 20 wins, 2 losses, and a draw, 42 years old. I've messaged a bunch of times with Carlos. Really nice guy, actually. Really nice guy. So shout out to the Drop Man. He's fighting former interim world title challenger, Liker Ramos, who is 20-12. And Liker fought, or Lacar, fought 3 times last year, Gray, at light middleweight, super middleweight and light heavyweight. And we're going to be somewhere over the 220-pound mark for this one in Panama.
Woo!
It's literally as good as it gets. So we're going to hope for the best on this show from Panama. We also have Keandre Leatherwood, super middleweight from the U.S., fighting on this show. And this one's going to be hit and miss. I don't think, oh man, we got to pray that we're going to see this one because it could be spectacular. All right, drum roll.
All right.
If we had one. Number two. Yes, you asked for it. The Dragon King himself. Chinese heavyweight who many have, I think, questioned whether he actually exists. Junlong Zhang, 18-0 with 18 knockouts, is headlining in, of all places, Ontario, Canada. Actually, he lives in Canada now, which is kind of a strange little nugget. And as you would expect with a card of this magnitude, it's available for the price of $50 Canadian, Gray, on Saturday night.
I really think we need to emphasize to viewers who do not know who Junlong Zhang is, but he was this fighter based in China, a heavyweight, so not a lot of those out there, who was, again, he is 18-0, all 18 wins by knockout, and his wins were just popping up on BoxRec, first round KO, second round KO, and what was really interesting was the level of opposition was, they were guys you probably heard of, like he third round stoppage over Jason Gavern, second round stoppage over Brazilian heavyweight George Arias, first round knockout over former world title challenger Rogelio Omar Rossi of Argentina. How about this one, Tim? First round knockout.
Take it easy on this one. Be very careful on how you say this.
Great friend of the show and friend of Tim Boxeo. And I'm sure this was a legitimate fight. Nothing happened here. He just caught him on the top of the chin and he got unlucky. Saul Farah did fight, apparently fought Junlong Zhang. So I need you on Facebook, on Messenger, asking for the scouting report. What do we get? We need it. We need it.
In his last fight, he knocked out South African legend Osborne Machimana.
One round.
Big Daddy.
The Big Daddy.
In one round.
One round. So we finally get to actually see this guy fight. The promoter of the show, I guess, you know, I don't know what their business relationship is, but I guess he got him over to Canada, and it's time to let the beast out of the cage. The Dragon King will finally rise from the ashes. Outside of Ali Raimi just tweeting I'm not actually dead, this is the most shocking comeback in boxing for me. I want to know what this guy can actually fight. I want to, because I'm going to say it to him, I don't know any of his fights were real. I don't know. I've never seen footage. I wasn't there. I'm not the boxing editor for China. It's a lot of questions here, because a lot of the guys he knocked out are typically sturdy fighters. So I have to wonder what the hell is going on, but we're going to find out, I guess, if you're willing to pay $50 Canadian.
What's really, really interesting, they've got him listed in BoxRec as 6'3", southpaw. The last, 1, 2, 3, 4, the last four fights, no weights listed.
Exactly.
The 2016 fight, they've got him weighing in at 282 pounds. Two fights before that, 275, yeah. 273, 273. So this is a big boy. And Gray, listeners of the show would expect this out of us. This afternoon, late this afternoon, right before we got on the recording, I went back and found the last fight of his opponent for Saturday night.
Love it.
Guillermo Casas from, God bless, Tijuana, Baja, California, Mexico. Ooh. Goes by Totoy. And Totoy is 5'11", as we would expect our Mexican heavyweights to be.
Absolutely.
And he is 10-2-1.
Good.
And fans of the show may remember a certain Mexican heavyweight by the name of Chachita. Well, Chachita has just finished a trilogy with Gonzalo Lopez Rodriguez, and that's who our guy Tutoy fought in his last fight. Perfect. Down in Tijuana in October, and took a unanimous decision against Gonzalo Lopez Rodriguez, who fell to 3-6-2. And how should I say this? I'm not trying to deter you spending $50 Canadian dollars on this, but Guillermo Casas is probably better suited for the super middleweight division, number one. And number two, the 10-2-1 record might be slightly inflated.
Might be. Well, I think either way, we're going to get some phenomenal footage on YouTube if it makes it up there.
Yeah, there's no doubt.
Like, we're going to be talking about this fight. I have a sneaking suspicion if it actually takes place. Because I believe the only Zheng Long Zhang fight I've seen, maybe it's up there and I need to go do some more searching, but I think I saw like his third or fourth pro fight. So I'm going to go maybe look around for more, but I don't know enough about this guy to really say, if he's good or bad, really, in all seriousness. I'm not as well versed at him as I was in Ali Raimi. I mean, I feel like I'm an Ali Raimi scholar at this point. I've seen so much Ali Raimi fight footage over the years. I've seen shit that got immediately taken off YouTube a day later. Like, I've seen some crazy Ali Raimi footage that I wish I had just recorded off my computer, but I was a dumb, young and dumb. So I say this with sincerity. Consider buying this pay-per-view, because you may never see Yang Long Zhang again after this. Or you might. Who knows? But we're getting to see someone who's just been a legend on the BoxRec website, finally in the flesh.
Instead of, I said three. Instead of adding a third, let's just spend like another minute or two here on this card. So here's another beautiful thing about this show.
All right.
Is it's $50 Canadian, and there is nothing else on this event. We've got two bouts on the lower part of the card. All four fighters are debutantes.
Perfect.
There's a female bout, a 2-1 versus 9-8-2. Nothing there. But there is another heavyweight fight. And so let me tell you really quick about this one.
Okay.
So Jordan Smith, 3-1-1, 6-5. Looks like he's more of a lifelong cruiserweight. Fights against a guy that actually I'm familiar with by the name of Jay Beard, who's 0-4, and he's 40 years old. Jay's got an amazing story. He actually has a long... He's 40. He turned pro in 2019. He had a long amateur career. Got in a lot of trouble as a 19-year-old kid, to say the least. Went inside on, I believe it was I don't even want to say it because I don't want to... It was something very bad. And he served, he served 17 years.
Oh, boy.
And he turned his life around, came out, started boxing, tried to, piece some things together. But they just made some missteps in managing him. He's actually a damn good boxer, considering his age. And so I did a podcast all on Jay Beard back on my old Tim Boxeo feed.
Okay.
If you want to go and listen to that, it's kind of interesting. But I'm looking forward to see that fight because Jay can fight. So two heavyweight fights, but this is exactly what I want when I spend an egregious amount of money on a club show. Is egregious the right word? This should be 50. I would pay 60 for this.
I'd be 75 if you guarantee me Ali Raimi comes back from the dead. Like, I'd throw another fucking $15 in there. He just comes in with, his entourage with their fucking AKs, just dance into the ring. Yeah.
Oh. This is spectacular.
I can't believe we haven't even gotten... Dude, we're like an hour 20 in. No, we didn't even talk about Zerto. We didn't talk about Charlo. We didn't even talk about Tony Yoka. You're not here for that. That's not what you're here for. I think what got today was a breakdown of all the shit on the fringes. Hopefully, Tim, is there anything else you want to cover before we wrap up, man? Because, like I said, there's just so much going on, but I feel like a lot of it's going to be in your newsletter, but I feel like we got the high points here.
I mean, I'd prefer to stay Switzerland than offend some people, but the only thing I'm looking forward to when Tony Yoka enters the ring is a nap. because he's put me into like nap-inducing comas the last three fights. So that's what I'm expecting when that fight goes down.
I think Bacoli can at least punch more than the last two guys that fought Yoka. Like, and is at least more of a risk. I mean, he's a pretty raw fighter for sure, but that element of what happens if he does land one on Tony Yoka makes it interesting for me. But I agree that it could get very boring very quickly if we realize that Bacoli cannot figure Tony Yoka's style out. It could be a very, very long 30 minutes.
I see it happening bad either way. Like, if that happens, or if the first thing you said happens and Yoka's like, oh shit, I just got clipped, it's going to be safety only mode for the next nine rounds.
It's a jab. It's movement. I think we're going to get a lot of that anyway out of Tony Yoka. I don't think he's going to take too many risks because I'll say Bacoli's one thing basically is that he can absolutely put your lights out if he lands. Has seen it many times. But he's also not the most fleet of foot in there. He can be easily outboxed, but he has good power. I mean, he's one of the few guys to stop Kevin Johnson, for Christ's sake. So,
hey, joking aside, I am super, super I love Jermell Charlo, so I'm super excited for this rematch with Castano. It's going to be, the first fight was so good, and I cannot wait for Saturday night. Yeah, Boots, I'm Boots, super excited.
Yeah, I mean, Boots is a must-watch also. I mean, you get both of those fights, two fights right there. I'm going to turn into them. And then you're telling me there's going to be a 6'9" Armenian heavyweight named Gergen Hovhannassian on the undercard? Yeah, I'm tuning in. I'm interested. You've got my attention, PC. Okay? So
you did it.
Yeah, listen, I'm not a big Zerto guy. I don't hate him or anything, but this Zerto card real quick, there's not much here for me. Nothing that really whets my appetite. I like William Zepeda against Rene Alvarado. I think that will be a fun bout. This is a Tim Boxeo exclusive here. So don't yell at me if this doesn't end up happening. So just beware. I think it's going to be announced, if it hasn't yet, it will be soon. Katsuma Akitsugi, you remember him? He fought Gregory Morales a few weeks ago. And he's on a crazy run. He's beaten three straight undefeated fighters. They're going to give him a 10-round fight on the undercard, and he's the A-side for once. So,
oh wow,
yeah, good for El Japoncito. That makes me really happy that they actually see some talent with that guy. But apparently, he got added to the undercard. So, because Diego De La Hoya is not on the show, because like every Diego De La Hoya fight, it actually never happens. So, I've noticed.
Me too. He deserves that fight. That's a tip of the cap. So, the only thing that does, I mean, this, but the Ramirez Bissell fight actually could be decent for as long as it lasts, only because Bissell is just so, I don't want to say raw, what's the right way to describe him, he just kind of more kind of crude, like he's just in there to kind of brawl. So
he doesn't really give a shit if he gets knocked out, I've noticed.
And he doesn't have a lot of power. But that could be a good fight. His Bissell's two fights with Krasniqi were really, really entertaining.
Yes.
So he'll be there to fight for sure. Don't get it twisted. It's just a matter of, does, you know, Ramirez, does Zerto just blast him out in like two rounds, and it's the levels are so different. Right. That'll be the thing.
Yeah, I agree. Well, I think that's gonna wrap things up, Tim, because we're almost at the hour and a half mark. So much to talk about, but again, I feel like we barely scraped the surface with this weekend. So once again, in addition to, you know, please continue to subscribe, listen to this podcast, but go read Tim Boxeo's newsletter, go to his Stanza, and go, you know, free streaming links all over the place. It'll be a very, very busy weekend. You know, that's where you need to, that's your viewer guide, that's where you get the supplementary information. But yeah, we appreciate that you continue to, we're on this weird podcasting journey, guys. I don't know how long the show will last, where it will go, but Tim, man, it's, I'm glad we're doing this, dude. It's been a pleasure getting to work with you and, just shooting the shit. And, weekends like this, where it's a good problem to have, right? When there's not enough time and there's too much to talk about.
Me too, man. I've had so much fun. It's been a real pleasure, like someone that in yourself that just shares the passion for all this weird shit that I do. And you know, you see some really good fights along the way when you focus on this part of boxing, and some really exciting prospects, and you know, it's a fun piece of the sport to keep an eye out for. So certainly really, really appreciate everyone that's listening. And let's keep after it.
Absolutely. I hear you. And I encourage you, in addition to all the funny stuff we talked about, yeah, like there's so many cards this weekend. You know, if you have time out before the pay-per-view start, perhaps go watch a smaller show. Go just sit back and enjoy some of these smaller cards out there, because I guarantee you, you're going to find something that between two fighters you've never heard of that might, you know, just blow your mind. There's enough shows out there that perhaps one of the best fights of the year will occur, and very few of us will know about it. The chances seem fairly high that it will happen. So, but in the meantime, thanks for listening to the show. Come back next weekend. Stay in shape. You know, just keep going, guys. Listen, I got hit by a car. Well, I was in the passenger seat. I'm still rolling. Hope you are too. Once again, I'm Professional Boxing Podcast. I'm Gray. You can follow me at BoxRecGrey on Twitter. Hit me up on gray@boxrec.com. If you got any questions you want us to read, we will do a mailbag segment. If you send us in DMs or comments, we will read them on air. Tim, tell us where we can find you on the internet.
Yeah, at Tim Boxeo on Twitter, and subscribe. Go to there on Twitter, click on my link tree, and subscribe to that Substack newsletter that just is getting started. It's all free. The Stanza live streaming schedule is free. Giving it all away, so go get it all. It's a passion and an obsession, so I spend more time on that than I do in any other portion of my life, I think, good or bad. So there it is.
Hell yeah, brother. Listen, every day is for boxing. Boxing will be everywhere this weekend. Continue the revolution. Stay the course. For Tim Boxeo, my name is Boxrec Gray. This is the Unprofessional Boxing Podcast. We'll be back next week.